May it please the court, Christopher Hart on behalf of the appellant Temecula Oaks Partners. Begin, I would like to thank the panel for the opportunity to present the argument, hearing some of the subject matter of the other cases. I can only imagine how much fun it must be to hear about a bankruptcy court order dealing with a dispute between a real estate developer and a private equity lender. I'm also aware
of all our cases.
I am also aware that the result appellant seeks today requires a fairly precise reading, for lack of a better word, of the and cross-referencing of the loan documents. And I'm not going to repeat the critical path that I presented in our briefs.
Now, and you've done a good job with that, but as I understand it, there's two different ways of approaching this case. One is to say that the guarantee never covered the Twin Oaks loan in the first place. The other way to do it is to go back and look at the settlement agreement and see what it did. I'm interested in the first one. I read the guarantee. It refers to a note, not two notes. It's pretty clear the note being referred to in the guarantee is a Desert Highlands note, right?
I agree, Your Honor. Let me get there this way. You had the master agreement is the loan agreement.
No, and you've done a great job in your briefs walking us through this incredibly complicated and arcane transaction.
So
I just have a very narrow question.
Sure.
My narrow question is, assuming all that background, when I look at this guarantee, it speaks of guaranteeing a loan. And a note. That must be the Desert Highlands loan and note, must it not?
Yes, but it's broader than that because it says it is guaranteeing all of the borrower's obligation.
So do we have to accept your argument that it's kind of a wraparound loan in order for you to win this argument?
Yes, you do. You have to accept the argument that there was a loan agreement. And underneath that loan agreement were two promissory notes. Those two promissory notes wrapped themselves around. You had a guarantee that was an unconditional guarantee of the buyer's obligations under the loan agreement.
Do you agree that the bank would have gained nothing under this circumstance? The lender would have gained nothing under this circumstance, forgetting that bankruptcy was off in the distance, by getting two guarantees rather than one? In other words, the guarantee of the Desert Highlands note was a guarantee of the entire amount that ISA had loaned it.
IFA, Your Honor. Yes.
IFA, I'm sorry.
It was a second guarantee, an argument exists, would have been superfluous. It was unnecessary. You had the guarantee of the larger amount. The larger amount included the smaller amount. I know I noted this in my papers on the guarantee. I think it actually refers to the borrower's obligations under the notes, which...
No, it doesn't.
Yeah,
that's why I asked the question.
And the whereas clause specifically defines the note. It defines it as the loan, and it defines it as the Desert Highlands Associates loan of $4.95 million. That's the loan. And then every place else in the guarantee, it references the loan, which is a defined term. So how do you jump to you're guaranteeing a different note?
Because if you go to the loan agreement again, both notes were part of that loan agreement, and both notes were a borrower's obligation. And so the guarantee, by virtue of the fact that it was unconditional and it unconditionally guaranteed and secured the overall loan, secured both the $4.95 million as well as the $3.75 million. And another point to make on that is the way this was structured was unique in that the only amounts that were going to be owed that were not secured by possession, that being the loan origination fees and the interest reserve, was the $3.75 million. And so when they executed those documents, I submit that the guarantor knew full well that that was going to be the amount that if he was called upon to make good for the borrower, it was going to be $3.75 million.
So are you saying that let's assume again we're not in bankruptcy land, and the borrower, the lender sued on this guarantee, it could only recover $3.5
million? What I would submit.
The lost argument seems to cut against your larger point, which is that he really knew he was only on the hook for the 3.5.
Well,
that would argue that there's no guarantee of that other 1.2.
Well, no, and perhaps I was being too cutesy with that. What I was trying to say is there was additional security for the difference between 3.75 million and 4.95 million. Specifically, there was an interest reserve which was being held by IFA at that time.
You know, now your claim is for the whole 4.95. It's best case scenario, it's only 3.75 million, right?
That's correct. That's correct.
So at least 1.2 million of your claim is clearly barred.
There is no dispute on that.
And there's no dispute that under the settlement agreement, the Desert Highlands loan was settled, right?
No. It was not, and I can get there. What the trial court found was that that loan was settled, and when that loan was settled, the corresponding guarantor liability was released. And the court cites a single piece of evidence, this being the Exhibit A. And the court seems to come to the conclusion that Exhibit A constituted all of the settled loans.
Well, I guess I'm okay. I don't mean to interrupt you here, but I thought that you only were arguing that it was the 12 Oaks note that wasn't settled. So, if the Desert Highland note wasn't settled, why do we even care about the 12 Oaks note? Because everybody agrees the Desert Highlands note was guaranteed by the guarantee.
Yeah, as I continued through and we talk about the failure to get bankruptcy court approval, what was not settled was loan number 27-019. That includes both the Desert Highlands.
So your position is the entire 4.75 million was not settled.
That's correct. But my damages are only 3.75
million. I understand, but I didn't. Your position is that none of the Desert Highland stuff was settled.
No, it was not.
Well, then why aren't you asking for the full amount again?
Because the difference between 3.75 and 4.95 is not owing. That money was paid. That additional $1.2 million. That being
because you stand in the shoes of the lender.
Correct.
As to that, and the
as
lender
as the assignee, we stand in the shoes, and so nobody is disputing.
So in your view, then what did the settlement agreement settle?
The settlement agreement settled. The settlement agreement in and of
you seem to be saying the settlement agreement settled nothing.
No. The you can't tell which loans got settled and which loans did not get settled by looking solely at that settlement agreement, and I'll tell you why.
But the settlement agreement does list the Desert Highlands loan as one of the ones that's being settled, and you're saying, it really didn't.
No, the only place it's listed, Your Honor,
is in the Exhibit of Loans.
And Exhibit A was never designed to be a list of settled loans. Exhibit A was a list of all of the loans that ran the history of the debtor Randall Blanchard and the lender IFA. That was a long history of many, many loans. In fact, there are a number of loans on Exhibit A that were fully paid loans, and nobody's suggesting
why include that in the settlement document?
Probably just so that we knew where we were starting. Here's a list of all the loans that have ever existed between us.
Then where in the settlement agreement do I look to see the loans that were settled? Is it in the settlement agreement?
It is not, Your Honor.
How can you have a settlement agreement that settles loans that doesn't tell you what the loans are, but you do have a document that says attached as Exhibit A, which are all the loans? I mean, that makes absolutely no sense to me.
I am not going to defend why the attorneys that drafted it did it that way, but the reasoning goes like this. The agreement says we're going to settle all of the loans. But before we can actually settle those loans, we need two things. There's two conditions subsequent to it. First, we got to get investor approval because that's required by Nevada law. I got to get a majority of the investors in that loan to approve the settlement. If I get that approval, I then got to go off to the bankruptcy court and I have to file what is known as a bankruptcy code section 9019 motion and seek approval.
And they got that.
They got it for the loans that got settled.
Okay, but tell me what loans got settled. How do I look at this agreement under your view and tell me what loans got settled?
You can't.
And the because so your you view, because I guess I'm back where I started. Your view is that this, under your interpretation of the settlement agreement, you don't care about the other ones because they're not your client's concerns. But if you were reading it as a matter of contract law, you would say it settled no loans.
No, I would go then to the 90-19 motion, which was the
I'm just not. I'm not worried about bankruptcy court. I'm looking at the settlement agreement.
I agree.
And you say on its face it is null, void, and ab initio because it doesn't describe the. It doesn't sufficiently describe the loans that were settled.
I'm just saying it required a condition subsequent that unquestionably did not occur.
Well, let's put that issue aside. How do I tell what this settlement agreement was intended to cover? Let's assume they met they got the subsequent conditions. What does it cover?
That's
nothing, you say, right?
That's right, because you don't know which loans were going to be subject
to settlement.
But then what's
the point?
Well, because again, this is a product of bankruptcy procedure.
Our first question is, after all, if the settlement agreement said we exclude this loan, I don't care about bankruptcy procedure. So I want to figure out, reading this settlement agreement, what obligations are being released.
Yeah, because it specifically excludes some loans. So how do we know what? So why, when it does that, why can't we assume it then settles everyone that it doesn't exclude?
And again, it meant to cover all the loans. It's just that you wouldn't know if ultimately those loans were settled until you got the investor approval and you got the bankruptcy court order. I can concede that the settlement agreement was designed to settle all the loans, big picture loans, with the exception of the two exceptions of 2.5 and 2.6, which I would very much like to address the language on that. But you don't know ultimately whether any one loan got settled until you take into consideration
why don't we know that from the release? Section 5 says, as between the Blanchard parties and the IFA, we release all claims whatsoever of any kind with the language. So we've got no claims left against you, but we have an exception, and that's 2.6.
Yeah.
Therefore, the claims, any claims related to the Desert Highlands note must have been released.
And let me, on your latter point, I would like to point something out because I think it's very interesting. Exhibit A gets introduced in the settlement agreement in the recitals, right? Recital A says all the Blanchard loans listed in Exhibit A. It also says every single Blanchard loan is guaranteed. There is a corresponding guarantee for every single Blanchard loan. The language says that. You then go to 2.5 and 2.6. In 2.5, of course, it reserves a different loan that is uninvolved, the Sandcastle loan, and it says we are going to reserve our rights as to the note against the borrower, but we are going to release Mr. Blanchard from his guarantee. But then in 2.6, when you get to the 12 Oaks note, it says we're reserving all rights.
But let me just go back to your first premise, because now I understand the problem that you pose. It really doesn't matter what's in Exhibit A, does it?
No.
If a lender and a borrower sign something that says I absolve you of all obligations except for the accepted ones, then and you agree that the Desert Highlands note is not one of the accepted ones.
No.
Right. I mean, the accepted ones is only the Twin Oaks note.
The 12 Oaks note,
right,
which was part
Oaks.
Of the Desert right, right. Highlands loan.
So, but you agree that the Desert Highlands note is not accepted.
I would agree that it is not it's not reserved specifically for
right.
in the settlement agreement. But
I'm letting you off the hook for everything. I'm letting you off the hook for everything except any obligation you may have. As with 12.6, any rights of any party
right.
concerning the 12 Oaks.
Now, what I will say is when you look at the exhibits to the Rule 90-19 motion, and of course, the bankruptcy judge has an independent obligation to review the merits of any settlement involving a bankrupt entity, and that's why you have such all those exhibits, and there's it breaks down what the investor approval was, it breaks down how much the loan was worth, and it breaks down how much the return to investors and how much the bankrupt was stood to return. The bankruptcy judge is required to make that finding to approve a settlement like this, and we know by looking at that motion that she did not approve the settlement of the Desert Highlands loan, and she did not approve the settlement of the 12 Oaks loan. I can see my time is up.
Yes, thank you, counsel. We'll give you a minute for rebuttal.
Thank you.
Let's hear from the trustee.
Good morning, Your Honors. Teddy Kapoor representing Richard Pachulski, the plan administrator and former Chapter 11 trustee in the bankruptcy case of Randall Blanchard. In this appeal, the appellant has been found to lack standing, and it's trying to resuscitate this guarantee that was released by the settlement.
Although the standing issue, to be fair, is the same as the merits issue. In other words, the standing issue is, look, it's not, you know, the court finds that your argument doesn't work, and therefore you don't have standing. It's not like they don't have Article III standing. It's not like they don't have a stake in the outcome. So for me, talking about standing confuses the issue.
I would disagree if I could spend a little bit of time, because I think that is a threshold issue of standing. And it's that Temecula Oaks is not the real party in interest, and that's important under Federal Civil Procedure 17.
That's not what the district court found. The district court didn't say, you're not an appropriate assignee, or you don't stand in the shoes of somebody else. What the district court said, using language from California cases to be sure, is that if you're not entitled to collect on this loan, then you don't have standing to. But,
well, you know, Temecula Oaks asserts that it has standing based on two assignments, because the guarantee was made from Mr. Blanchard to IFA.
Right.
And Temecula Oaks has to make a reach to say that it has rights in this guarantee because of two assignments, one from IFA to investors, and then secondly from the investors to Temecula Oaks.
All they're trying to do is assert IFA's rights in this proceeding. And if IFA has no rights, then they have no standing.
That's
what the district court said.
Right, and that's what the bankruptcy court said.
But it didn't say there was something wrong with the assignments or anything else. Well, the district court said IFA couldn't have enforced this guarantee against you because it released it.
Well, the bankruptcy court, they both did find, I believe, in pages 11, 20, and 21, and then the bankruptcy court, page 439 in the record, that the first assignment was flawed. Like the first assignment, which you have a copy of starting on page 161, it only purports to assign a beneficial interest in the note and deed of trust, the Desert Highlands note and deed of trust.
So the court
there's
said,
never an assignment of the guarantee.
So the district court said you assigned the note, and you can sue on the note, you can sue on the security, but you can't sue in the guarantee because the guarantee wasn't assigned.
Right. And without that assignment of the guarantee, which is the basis of the claim, that's why you lack standing.
But let's get back to...
Right. We can,
let me tell you what I find confusing about these documents, and my guess is, having had to labor in these fields once, nobody ever thought about this issue when they were drafting the documents one way or the other. Why doesn't the guarantee, whether or not they can sue on it, why doesn't the guarantee cover the 12 Oaks, 12 Twin Oaks, whatever it is, the second loan?
Because they're separate loans, Your Honor. I mean, this is a stretch that the appellant is now trying to argue that the settlement agreement does nothing, even though IFA, Desert Highlands, Blanchard, all signed onto the settlement agreement that was then sent to the bankruptcy court in Nevada and approved. But there are separate deeds of trust, there are separate notes. The 12 Oaks note is separate from the Desert Highlands note. And just because the proceeds of the 4.9 went to pay the 12 Oaks note doesn't mean that they're a wraparound loan or a single loan. That argument was considered by the bankruptcy court, considered by the district court, and found to fail. And it also is belied by the documents in the case. So the guarantee, the loan agreement, and the settlement agreement all make clear that these were separate notes and separate obligations.
I want to go back to the standing argument for a second, because there were two assignments.
Yes.
So the standing argument doesn't work for the second assignment, does it?
Oh, it says that if IFA didn't transfer the guarantee to the investors had no interest in the guarantee than to
right.
transfer
and to the... Is that true for the second assignment also?
Yes. Assignment we have on page 341.
Right. So your view is that neither assignment transferred the guarantee.
Yes, sir.
They just transferred the rights of the lender, did it not?
It says that it transferred the beneficial interest in the note and deed of trust, of the Desert Highlands note and deed of trust
right.
only.
So your view is that doesn't take with it all the rights that the person who previously held the beneficial interest had?
No, Your Honor. Without any reference to the guarantee, that's a separate obligation.
Judge,
and the district court
Roy
found
the
same.
Question.
Well, I guess I got a little bit confused by your opposing counsel's argument. Who is the claimant in this case? Is it Desert Highlands or is it Twin Oaks?
The person who filed the proof of claim is Temecula Oaks Partners.
Under an assignment from whom?
Under two assignments that both courts found didn't happen. An assignment first from, because the guarantee was made in favor of IFA. So IFA would have then had to transfer it to investors, and then the investors have to transfer it again to Temecula Oaks.
But at the end of the day, the rights that are being pursued are the rights of ISA.
IFA.
Right,
under the guarantee.
Sorry. too many letters. Right?
Right.
Right. So these Temecula Oaks folks stand in the shoes of the lender. You're just saying they only stand in one shoe of the lender. They stand in the note shoe of the lender,
note
but not the guarantee.
But
not the guarantee shoe.
Right. Well, okay. What's your response to your opposing counsel's argument that if you look at all the documents, not just the release, and specifically if you look at the motion and order of the bankruptcy court, it was clear from that motion and order that it was not the intent to release any of the obligations of his client?
I think it's, again, a stretch. Both courts, lower courts, found that the settlement agreement is clear, that...
Well, whether you call it an ambiguity that's cleared up by the motion or whether you call it a condition precedent that was never met...
I think that, it is important. I think that the appellant is misrepresenting the nature of these exhibits. He points to exhibits B, C, D, and E in the record, and he says that we should look at those. But... First, the district court considered that argument on page 1137, and it said none of the exhibits shows that the Desert Highlands loan was not settled. Instead, they show that IFA did not include that loan in these lists, which show proposed settlement payments to investors. That's the first argument. Secondly, what's critical here is that those exhibits are not exhibits to the settlement agreement. They're exhibits to a motion, and unfortunately, that motion's not in the record. We have an earlier version of that same motion that starts on page 200.
It's not in the bankruptcy court record?
Well, it's not in the excerpt of record before, Your Honors.
Why not? But is it in the bankruptcy court record?
Yes, that document.
So we can surely look at, we don't have to look at prior versions.
Well,
we can look at the bankruptcy court record.
Good, and in that, and if you go back to read the motion, though, so it'll describe those exhibits.
When you say it's not in the record, you just didn't send it to us.
Right, yeah, yes. Sorry.
So what does the motion say?
The motion says that exhibit of 13 loans are loans that had not been paid in full. So the fact that this 27-019 is not listed there is because it was paid in full. So yes, you can go back to the motion, but I would ask Your Honor to review how those exhibits are described in the settlement motion. And page 200 has an earlier version that also describes those exhibits. But both the district court did look at those exhibits and found that it's clear that Exhibit A is the list of released loans.
Can I ask you a question that nobody seems to be addressing here? Therefore, I must have missed something. 2.6 accepts the 12 Oaks loan.
Right.
It doesn't affect the rights of any party to the 12 Oaks loan. The lender, ISA, is a party to the 12 Oaks loan, is it not?
It is.
Putting aside whether or not Mr. Blanchard guaranteed the 12 Oaks loan. Don't Temecula Oaks people have, don't they stand in the shoes of ISA with respect to the collection of that loan?
Without the guarantee?
Yes.
Sure.
But that's not against Mr. Blanchard, I take it.
Is right, that it's against the trustor there is the Desert Highlands LLC.
Right, and that Desert...
Or no, it's actually 12 Oaks LLC.
Right, and that entity is not involved. This is only a personal petition.
The only petition being made is Temecula Oaks.
No, I mean, in this case, the only only debtor is the individual.
Yes.
So they still, under your interpretation of this, the Temecula Oaks people would still have a right of action, perhaps not worth anything, against the borrower under the 12 Oaks note.
I'd have to look at that, Your Honor.
Well, you seem to be saying all they got was the beneficial interest of ISA.
Right.
ISA could have collected on that note against the borrower. They could too, correct?
Right.
But that's not what's in front of us.
Right, I mean, not in front of us, and these notes are separate. Even the settlement agreement, let's look at that Exhibit A and also Section 2.6. 2.6 says that we're going to exclude the 12 Oaks note, and it tells you in parentheses which one is the 12 Oaks note. It tells us, let's look at Exhibit A and only note O. Reading from 2.6, the agreement does not affect the rights of any party concerning the 12 Oaks loan, identified as Note O on Exhibit A. If it wanted to include the Desert Highlands, it could have said Note O and Note S, if there's really one loan. But there is there are two separate loans, two separate deeds of trust. And so the only way that the appellant can try to save its claim is to try to persuade us that it's a single loan, but it's not.
Well, no, but the other way he can save it, and that's why I started there, is to say, there's a guarantee on the 12 Oaks loan, and that's, if there were a guarantee on the 12 Oaks loan, you would agree that it would be accepted.
Right, but the guarantee does not.
That's right, so that's why I keep going back to what the guarantee says.
Yeah, and I think the guarantee, you're right, is clear. It refers, as Judge Malloy mentioned, only the $4.95 million Desert Highlands Associates loan and deed of trust. There's no mention of the separate 12 Oaks note in the separate 12 Oaks deed of trust that guarantees at page 3 to page 9.
Well, it does talk about the obligations under the loan agreement, though, doesn't it?
But that's the Desert Highlands loan agreement. And the district court considered this at page 1122.
Yeah, well, but doesn't the Desert Highlands loan agreement involve the 12 Oaks loan? In other words, the original loan agreement, which I have here, says we're going to loan you all this money and you're going to give some of it, you're going to put some of it in the 12 Oaks project, and we're going to document that by a separate promissory note.
Right, but also the loan agreement tells us at paragraph 816 that these are two separate transactions. And that's important.
Going to the settlement agreement for a minute, you know, the argument is that the Desert Highlands note is not covered. But it specifically is referenced in 2.4 of the settlement agreement, is it not?
It's specifically referenced in the...
But 12 Oaks note is not.
Right, right.
So you could look at 2.4 as a list of loans, at least at a minimum there, as to what had been settled, could you not?
I still submit that Exhibit A is all of the loans that were settled, except for the two that were accepted by provisions 2.5 and 2.6. That's clearly how the drafters intended. It's what the document says. And I think it's also important that Section 2.1 releases all guarantees, all Blanchard guarantees. And this proof of claim that we're here about is based on a guarantee. All the guarantees were released. That is without question, and it is very clear. So we don't get to the point of whether the guarantee covers somehow the 12 Oaks note. It doesn't. But the guarantee itself, all guarantees were released in 2.1.
Although I suppose then the question would be whether 2.6 is broad enough. It says all obligations, right? So 2.6, I'm trying to find the language, but it basically says any right of any party.
No, just,
so you're saying that
2.6 only points to this.
So if there were, let me ask the question. You're saying that even if the guarantee explicitly covered the 12 Oaks loan, let's assume it said, I mean to cover both of them. You think that we should read the settlement agreement as releasing the guarantee but not the obligations under the note?
Yes, because that it does. 2.1 says all Blanchard loans are hereby released, hereby and unequivocally released. And I, you know, some point was, questions were raised about the wraparound nature of the loan. I think that I do want to emphasize that the guarantee itself says that only references Desert Highlands. The loan agreement, paragraph 816, says there are separate transactions. The settlement agreement treats these as separate, note S versus note O. Mr. Dyer's testimony in prior proceedings said that there were two loans, two separate loans. That's at page 847. And the wraparound loans, this loan doesn't have the characteristics of a wraparound loan. And I'll point your honors to a case, In Re Club Associates, 107 BR 385. It describes what a wraparound loan is. And in a situation where you have a wraparound loan, the wraparound lender becomes liable for all the mortgages that are senior in priority directly. We don't have a situation here where we have Desert Highlands taking on the obligations to pay the other notes. We have two separate obligations, two distinct obligations with the notes and deed of trust, and there's no obligations in the loan agreement for the wraparound lender to take on the payments of other third-party lenders.
All right, counsel, you've exceeded your time.
Thank you.
Rebuttal. Let's start with 1 minute.
I did want to clear up one ambiguity. Opposing counsel said that the 9019 motion, the amended 9019 motion, was not in the record. That is untrue. Excerpt of record 0963 through 1009.
Yeah, I knew we had it. I just didn't know where it was.
I also want to point out that in the guarantee, under paragraph 1, where it says indebtedness guaranteed, it says that it covers the indebtedness guaranteed covers the note and any other loan document. And I would submit that if you go to the loan agreement and you that term loan document and loan documents are specifically defined, and it includes both notes, and it includes the and it also incorporates the guarantee within that. When opposing counsel says that all the guarantees were released under paragraph 2.1, to me, it begs the question, then why is there that language in section 2.5 that says we are releasing you from the guarantee but reserving our rights as to the loan? If the guarantee had already been released, there would have been no need for that language.
All right. Thank you, counsel. Thank you to both counsel for your helpful arguments. The case just argued is submitted for a decision by the court.